You may be seated. Dying, Christ destroys our death. Rising, Christ restored our life. Christ will come again in glory. As in baptism, Gail put on Christ, so in Christ may she be clothed with glory. Here and now, dear friends, we are God's children. What we shall be has not yet been revealed. But we know that when he appears, we shall be like him. For we shall see him as he is. Those who have this hope purify themselves as Christ is pure. Jesus said, I am resurrection and I am life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, yet shall they live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. For I am Alpha and Omega, beginning and end, first and last. I died, and behold, I am alive forevermore. And I hold the keys of hell and death. Because I live, you shall live also. Friends, we have gathered here to praise God and to witness our faith as we celebrate Gail's life. We come together in grief, we acknowledge our human loss, and we ask that God would grant us grace that in pain we may always find comfort, in sorrow we may always find hope, and in death we always find resurrection. I'll invite you now to rise and join me as we sing together our opening hymn, How Great Thou Art. Hymn 77.
Consider all.
You may be seated. Let us pray. Eternal God, we praise you for the great company of all those who have finished their course in faith and now rest from their labor. We praise you for those dear to us whom we name in our hearts before you. Especially this afternoon, we praise you for Gail, whom you have graciously received into your presence. To all of these, grant your peace. Let perpetual light shine upon them, and help us so to believe where we have not seen, that your presence may lead us through our years, and bring us at last with them into the joy of your home, a home not made with hands, but eternal in the heavens. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Throughout our life, we turn to Scripture for guidance, for wisdom, and for times of grief, we turn to Scripture for comfort. Our first scripture lesson today is Psalm 23, and I invite you to take that insert and we will read that together. Let us in unison say Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen. Our next psalm comes from Psalm 42. As the deer pants for streams of water, so my soul pants for you, my God. My soul thirsts for God, for the living God. Where can I go and meet with my God? My tears have been my food day and night, while people say to me all day long, where is your God? These things I remember as I pour out my soul, how I used to go to the house of God under the protection of the Mighty One, with shouts of joy and praise among the festive throng. Why, my soul, are you downcast? Why so disturbed within me? Put your hope in God, for I will yet praise Him, my Savior and my God. My soul is downcast within me, therefore I will remember you from the land of the Jordan, the heights of Hermon, from Mount Mizar. Deep calls to deep in the roar of your waterfalls. All your waves and breakers have swept over me. By day, the Lord directs his love. At night, his song is with me, a prayer to the God of my life. I say to God, my rock, why have you forgotten me? Why must I go about mourning, oppressed by the enemy? My bones suffer mortal agony as my foes taunt me, saying to me all day long, where is your God? Why, my soul, are you downcast? Why so disturbed within me? But put your hope in God, for I will yet praise him, my Savior and my God. Amen.
Amen. need for you. And someday on thee I'll stand. There my home shall be eternal. You I'm kind of homesick for a country to which I've never been before. No sad goodbye will there be spoken, and time won't matter anymore. You love me, I'm longing for you, and someday on thee I'll stand. There my home shall eternal, beautiful land, sweet beautiful land. I'm looking now across the river, where my faith shall end inside. There's just a few more days to labor, then I will my heavenly flight to Beulah. I'm longing for you, and someday on thee I'll stand. There my home shall be eternal. You
This time, some family members are going to come forth and share memories and speak about Gail. They'll be coming to this podium, and the handheld mic is right there for you to use. So we invite them to come forward at this time.
What can I say about my wonderful wife, Gail, after we had almost 53 years of marriage together? As a matter of fact, it would have been 53 years on Ash Wednesday. I could speak on for a long time, but I won't. Gail said she married me because I was the only man who said God and wasn't cussing. People often ask me, well, how did you meet? So I think I'll take a little time and explain that. In 1969, I was a young naval officer aboard a destroyer out of Norfolk, Virginia. One Saturday night, I really didn't have anything else to do, and I just went out to the ocean front on Virginia Beach. Saw the movie Easy Rider. Very depressing, and then I went across the hall, and there was a Christian coffee shop called The Upstairs, and they were playing The Wedding Song, which had just come out. So I told my buddy, John McCroskey, who was an officer on another ship in the squadron, about that, and he said, well, yeah, let's go. So we took off one Friday evening, and on the way I said, oh, by the way, I met these four girls who were living in a house. Why don't we stop by and see if any of them want to go with us? So we went by, and Gail and another were ready to go. So it wasn't a day, but we had dinner, and then we went to the upstairs. So then afterwards, Gail said, well, would you like to come and help us decorate the Christmas tree? Well, sure, yeah, sure I would. And so we decorated the tree, and I figured that was about it. Said, well, there's a party at the other end of the beach. Would you like to come along? So I go rolling into this party with seven girls in the car, and thought that was pretty cool. So anyway, Gail and I started dancing, and sparks started to fly, and we started dating and dated until March, and did a six-month deployment with the ship in the Mediterranean. Came back, and she was waiting on the pier for me, so that kind of really started things moving. Engaged by Thanksgiving and married by the following Valentine's Day. Okay. Our being born again, our increasing faith in our Lord Jesus Christ, was the bond that held us together during good times and challenging times. We always looked to him for guidance, even when we had disagreements about something. Gail was a Proverbs 31 lady. She did it all. From early marriage years, through child rearing, through empty nesting, through grandchildren, she sought to do everything in God's ways and accomplished so much. I could never have made it to where I am without her love, care, and support. She was the best helpmate I could have asked for. Doing so many things, such as recording grades for the college courses I was teaching, reviewing papers I had to write. She was pretty hard-nosed on them, too. Lots of corrections. Here, you use the same word three times in two sentences. I'm thankful that she liked to cook. By myself, it's mainly TV dinners. Someone I was proud to have by my side when attending church or any function. In her career, as well as in person, she devoted herself to helping others. Most of her many career positions were in the area of Christian education. She directed the Christian education program at a number of churches. Often included in those positions was directing the youth program. On multiple occasions, she drove a church bus full of teenagers to the Methodist Conference Center at Lake Junaluska for summer retreats. She made for some interesting times. She taught women's Bible studies and formed lasting friendships. Her last position working was Blacksburg United Methodist Church, and we have a few people who have come down from that church to be with us today. She also taught in the Christian school and directed a church preschool. Gail was a friend to all. If someone needed to be taken to the doctor's office or even to the UNC hospital, she stepped in. She impacted countless lives of adults as well as those of youth. I missed her every day. I could never envision my giving this message. There are always multiple things each day that remind her of her in our life together. Often simple things like, guess who I ran in today? Then realizing that I'm no longer able to tell her. Gail had no fear of dying. In fact, she looked forward to it. She experienced considerable pain as well as the increasingly debilitating effects of Parkinson's disease in her latter years. She was ready to go be with her Lord and Savior, to be absent from the body, but present with the Lord. To Gail, your love for me and our Lord has given me the ability to carry on without your bodily presence. I will always love you and miss you. And now I'll turn the podium over to daughter Amy.
Hello. Thank you all for coming. I know Mom would be honored to have all of you here. When I was about 7 or 8 years old, we were living in Tallahassee, Florida at the time, I woke up in the middle of the night with a tummy bug. I'm sure all of you know what a horror that can be for parents, often moms, and kids. My fuzzy visual recollection of the event includes the big green throw-up bowl placed on the floor by the side of the bed, the dim yellow light coming from the antique lamps on my dressing table, and the outline of my mother sitting on a chair by the side of my bed. I have a much clearer emotional recollection of the event, and it's a good one. Mom sat up all night long reading to me from Frances Hodgson Burnett's The Secret Garden. She transported me to a place of mystery, healing, and wonder, and I'm convinced this experience instilled in me a love of reading. I felt safe and cared for and supported. This memory captures an important aspect of who Mom was, a giver of care. Our little posse in Tallahassee always came to our house for treatment by Nurse Gail when one of us had a boo-boo. She was always there for friends when they needed companionship during a doctor's visit or assistance after surgery. She was a patient care advocate at a children's hospital of the King's Daughter in Norfolk, Virginia, and she nursed her entire family, my grandmother, my aunt, my grandfather, through surgeries, treatments, and even up until death. Another favorite and very important memory I have with Mom is being present for Papa's passing. I don't think I need to testify to her professional capacities. Many of you were involved in or witnessed to her work as a Christian educator, a youth leader, a camp director, and with the Girl Scouts. Many of you know of her skill as a musician. She had a great voice, sang in many choirs, and played the piano well. She was also a great friend, not just supporting her friends, but her friends' children also by, say, teaching them to read, getting them mental health care, or just being a listening presence. So I think I'll share a few more things about Mom, personal things that stay with me. An appreciation for music, up to and including the silly songs such as Alice the Camel or the Scooby-Doo theme song, something which now carries on to a third generation with my daughter, Ula. Variations on the Corn song, anyone? A love of British period dramas and mysteries. Even during the worst of the teenage years, we would bond over Masterpiece Theater on Sunday evenings. A love of the North Carolina mountains. Mom gave our family a tremendous gift by familiarizing us with these mountains and setting up a second home there. Family stories and traditions. I have great material for my Southern Gothic novel whenever I finally write it. And at Christmas, it's not sugar plum fairies, but little green Christmas tree cookies that dance in my head. Teaching and training skills. I'll never forget when I became a camp director for the first time and heard my mother's voice coming out of mine. There are more things I could share about Mom, but I know others are waiting their turn. I want to finish with a poem that has hung in our house for years. I think it says a lot about Mom, and I can hear her voice speaking through it. It's called Secret Sanctuary by Naomi Bartlett. Each person lives a part of life alone, surrounded by the one he loves best, the ones he loves best. There is a portion of his soul unknown, like caverns hidden by the ocean's crest. And though he longs to share in joy or gloom this inner shrine that all of us possesses, he cannot ask his friends in. There is no room. He enters there enwrapped in loneliness. Within the sanctuary, dreams are born. Far too often, he has seen them dead. Alone, he stands beside their bier to mourn, or else give birth to other dreams instead. God builds in every heart a secret place that in aloneness we might seek his face.
It's good to see everybody here today as we take this time to remember my mother, Gail Herring, and celebrate her life. She would be pleased to see everybody here today. The last 4 years were a difficult struggle for her. She fought hard, but it was not easy. One of the primary reasons for this was that she, at least it seems to me, was most comfortable in the role of teacher and caregiver for others, or as a sounding board for her friends. When she could no longer provide these services because of Parkinson's, she retreated into privacy, as I think many of us would have in, if we were in the same situation. If some of you have heard little from my mom over the past years, please know that it was nothing personal. It was just Mom being Mom and not wanting to burden others with her struggle. She valued all of you immensely. I'm excited and hopeful that others will share their memories of Gail today, as we all knew her in different ways. I feel like she was a chameleon in personality, always molding herself to others in an effort to make them feel most comfortable while not changing her core character. Gail was a wonderful mother to my sister Amy and I, taking good care of us, especially when we were ill or feeling down. If you haven't noticed already, there's some themes that run through my dad's memories and Amy's as well. She was a caring grandmother, too. She was known as Nurse Grammy. I think Amy said she was known as Nurse Gail when we were young, and she was known as Nurse Grammy a little bit later on when the grandkids came. She loved her grandchildren dearly. One of the hardest parts of her battle with Parkinson's was that she was not as involved in the lives of her grandchildren as she wanted to be. However, that did not stop her from always asking about them and making most of the time that she did have with them during their visits. Gail was a devoted Christian, spent much of her life in Christian education and being involved in the church youth at several different churches. She had a special way with youth, and I witnessed her comfort and care for many teens over the years who were struggling with issues that were far deeper or harder than mine. Some of my favorite times growing up were on youth retreats to Lake Junaluska or Cape Hatteras with youth groups led by my mother and with friends that I made as a result of her involvement in the youth of several different churches. We had a station wagon we affectionately named Mary when we were growing up that was put to good use in her youth ministry, as it could easily hold 12 people. So some of you guys probably remember this. She also had a great sense of humor that would often have other kids rolling in laughter. Gail also loved the children of others, especially those of her good friend Mary Dickerson, who have grown up to be three exceptional young women and who call her godmother. Mom loved history, and she loved music. In her final months, when her pain and anxiety were brought under control, I was reminded of this as we had several surprisingly deep conversations about the world and history that we would not have had been able to have only months earlier. She always let us know how much she loved us too, when we were leaving, no matter how much she was hurting. I'm grateful for the time we were able to spend with her in her final days as a family and the memories that we shared. The music we listened to, Sound of Music, and good friends that were there to help. Though I miss her, I know she's in a better place with the Lord that she was devoted to and no longer struggling. I want to acknowledge the incredible care and patience provided by my father, Bob Herring, over these last years. I also want to thank our neighbors on Somerset Place for their concern and care for our parents, and to all of you here today for your concern. Thanks, everybody, for being here to celebrate and honor this wonderful life. All right, I'm going to stop crying now, because now's hopefully the fun part. Anybody that knows my mom knows that she was a storyteller, and that was her love language, telling stories. She's kind of the keeper of the history of the family, so we would love anybody that wants to speak to please do so. Please share your stories with us. Thank you.
There are many words I would use to describe Gail: confidant, protector, nurturer, role model, compassionate, among many others. Gail was the most loving, caring, positive influence in my life. My family moved next door to Gail's family when I was 2 and Gail was 17. Gail took me under her wing then and was there for me my whole life. When Gail and Bob were in California and had young kids, I spent summers with them. Although I'm sure it wasn't convenient for them, they brought me into their loving family when I had none. Whether she was in town or far away, I could always call her, and she was always there, celebrating my good times and helping me with the bad times, never judging me, just being there for me. She could literally read my mind, and she always knew when I needed her. When each of our 3 daughters were born, she was there for me and was there for them throughout their whole life. Gail and Bob are their godparents, and the girls adore them. Gail was fun and loving and gave me ideas of dealing with 3 kids all 18 months apart. Thank God Gail was there to help. When our middle daughter, Julie, was being born, Gail came and stayed with our oldest, Laura, who was a toddler. Laura can probably still remember the page number for what Laura called hoppers in the children's Bible Gail had given her. And Gail faithfully read that chapter over and over and over to Laura so she could see her favorite page. Julie remembers the little Tykes table Gail set up in our kitchen where Gail would let them finger paint and other fun activities. This would always end up with Julie covered in head to toe in finger paint, but Gail would just laugh and wash her off in the tub. Lisa remembers the crafts Gail made for them, such as pajamas, aprons, sweatshirts, and many others, always individualized for each girl. The girls and I had great adventures with Gail, to simple visits to neighborhood parks, to their mountain house, to the Children's Museum, Natural Science Center, and many others. Gail took the time for them that no one else did. I never imagined I would be without Gail in my life, and I truly don't know where I would be without her. I want to model my life after her, to have her faith in God, to be a good person, to have a good attitude even when life was hard. She cared about me and was there when I needed her, and she truly changed my life. From the bottom of my heart, I will always love you, Gail, and will always try to make you proud of me.
Can you hear me? I'll try and be loud. My name is Cindy Beach, and Gail was my friend. I cried a lot putting these thoughts together, but I'm going to try and read these without breaking down. Gail came to Blacksburg United Methodist on staff in the mid-90s, and I joined a Bible study group she was leading. The rest is history. We became fast friends. Any of you who know Gail know that there's no way you could have had a superficial relationship with her. She looked into my eyes, and I just spilled everything about my whole life, and in turn, she did with hers. We shared a deep and meaningful friendship. Marjorie was part of that group, too, and we developed a special bond, all while dealing with various life crises, aging parents, raising children at all stages, divorce, and illness among them. We shared many joys and sorrows together. Gail named our threesome the Sitting Bull Sisters, short SB sisters, but I think our husbands might have called us the BS sisters. Boy, did we have fun. We laughed, we cried, and we laughed even more. I can hear Gail laughing now. We had fun road trips, many women's retreats, to Gail and Bob's mountain house. She showed me Lake Junaluska and her love for that. Somehow, we always seemed to find the best ice cream stores or shops wherever we were. We all liked ice cream. These are times I will always treasure. Gail had a fun, sneaky side, too. When I got remarried to my husband, Randy, she surprised us at our reception with a box of, well, let's just say, things that made everybody in the room blush. I can still hear her smile that day and laugh and picture what I would call a devious smile. Gail exuded a beautiful glow rooted in her deep faith in Jesus. She had an uncanny ability to touch lives and help others find deeper faith. Gail was also the youth leader at our church, and she led an infamous youth retreat called the Hopping Hormones. And it is what it sounds like. And it was pretty infamous. And our children went through it, and we're very grateful for that. My children, three of my oldest children who were in her youth group, asked me to share a few thoughts from them. My daughter, Angela, says, Gail was always so full of joy and so much fun. She made youth group a blessing, and I learned to thank so much from her. I'm incredibly thankful for the role she played in my life. My daughter, Rebecca. Now, my daughters are in their 40s now. Gail is the reason I volunteer with our youth group today. Having an adult invest in my youth, in my life as a youth, was so impactful. She cared so much for us and chose to spend her time with us and pour into us, and it meant so much, especially at our age. And my son, Ian. Gail fostered an environment of love and compassion and helped us develop the vocabulary to ask big questions and to explore our ideas of spirituality and faith. She was full of grace and provided safe harbor and stability in a time of my life when I didn't know which way was up. Hers was a gentle nudge towards the light, and I am forever grateful for her. We're all richer for knowing Gail. Better people with a deeper understanding of our faith. And I thank God for bringing her into my life and for making such a difference in my children's lives and for her special friendship. The last time we spoke was very hard. Gail insisted that she wanted me to remember her as she was. And Gail, I promise you, I will always remember you. No one could ever take your place. And it was my honor to know and to love you, my friend.
The end of what Cindy is saying, she quotes from the song that I learned from Gail called Sanctuary. Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true, with thanksgiving. I'll be a living sanctuary for you. Sanctuary has been mentioned before. Gail was a sanctuary. She was for me. She walked me through the caring for and the end of life for my father, my mother, and my aunt. She was there. She held my hand. After they moved, she and Bob, to Greensboro, I was leading a Sunday school class that wanted to know about prayer. I felt so totally inadequate, but I knew who was more than adequate. So I got on the phone, and I called Gail, and I said, "Sister, I need you. My Sunday school class wants to know about prayer, and you can teach them. And I'll be there to step and fetch." So she came back to Greensboro, from Greensboro to Blacksburg. And she and I were coming down the hall from the education building, cutting up and carrying on like we usually did. And the new youth director, a young man named Todd, came flying out in the hall and looked at us and he said, "Were you all the ones making that noise?" Uh-huh. We had a good time whenever we were together. Her laughter is something I will treasure, and I can still thank the Lord, hear it in my heart. To you, her grandchildren, I'm a grandmama. I know what grandmama's pride is. Let me tell you something. Her pride in you was unbounded. When we would talk on the phone, I would hear what each and every one of you were doing and thinking, and how tall you were, and how gorgeous you are. And I guess, once again, she was my sanctuary and my role model, so that the grandmama I am today, Gail gets some credit for. She was love. She was a sanctuary. I'm so thankful that we got to be SB sisters together. Thanks.
Anybody else? All right. Okay. All right. Thank you.
My sister-in-law had a skill unlike anyone else. She had a PhD in psychiatry without ever having gone to school for it. I sort of had a rough deal when I went to college. Things did not turn out well for me. I never fell in with a good social group. I'm the youngest of the family, and my family was much changed by the time I came along. And I couldn't fool Gail. She would cast one look at me, and I would break down in tears if I had something that I was holding back from her. And as I went through life, through my 20s and 30s and 40s, she was always there for me, and always with this just really a gift from God, this brilliance and this human understanding. And I will always be grateful for that. And I also just want to say, I remember a wonderful 2 weeks in Chula Vista, California, when Bob was a young naval officer, And they invited me out to stay with them for 2 weeks in the summer before my senior year of high school. And I have to tell you, from a kid from Oxford, Mississippi, to go out there and hang out with them, they take me to the officers' club. What's the name of the place? The naval on Coronado Island? Yeah, North Island. I had just gone and jumped in the Pacific Ocean, always thinking it was a really warm ocean, and coming out as red as a lobster. And I can remember them taking me to the officers' club and letting me have a drink, actually, and watching the fighter pilots come in and the chutes popping out. Is that where they have the Top Gun school, Bob? Okay, yeah. And if I could just say it, something that was just with my brother, he took me to the bachelor officer's quarters so I could meet another one of their best friends who had not gotten hitched yet in life. And we come to a Coke machine, and my brother says, "Say, Ben, would you like a Coke?" And I said, "Yeah, I think I would." And he says, you got a quarter on you?" And I fished around. "Yeah, I got one." Put it in. And he said, "What do you want, a Coke or a Sprite?" So I said, "Well, let me put Sprite." And I put in my money and bum da dum da dum da boom. Out comes a Coors beer. And so Bob had a big grin on his face, and I had an even bigger grin about 10 or 15 minutes later into that beer. And while having dinner with them numerous times at their house, under their guideful presence, I was able to enjoy another Coors beer here and there. And I will just cap this off by saying that during that 2 weeks I was there, I have never in my life then nor at any time since or in any movie or film or stage play a couple more deeply in love. And it was a beautiful thing, and I'm so glad I witnessed it.
Anybody else?
I feel like what I have to say is very insignificant compared to what the rest of you have said.
Tell them your name.
I'm Ann Bourne Eagle. This is my sister Betsy Bourne, who was one of Gail's best friends from Sternberger School on. And for those of you not from Greensboro, Sternberger is an elementary school. she says I'm not speaking loud enough.
Can everybody hear?
Okay.
I was struggling to hear, but maybe it's just my hearing.
I think it's you.
Okay.
But anyway, when I came back to Colorado the spring of 1999, I got here for Easter. And our mother was elderly at that point and getting to the point where she couldn't come to church. But I was the one elected to take her to St. Andrew's, which is a church we grew up in. After the Diocese of Colorado, that was a dead church. So as soon as she was not able to go to church, Gail grabbed me and said, "I want you to go to Muir's Chapel with me. Our Sunday school class was doing something. I don't remember what. Does anybody remember? But anyway, we had something special going. And Gail brought me, got me involved, and I stayed there for 20 years. And some of our classes here, some of them are sick. And I don't know where the rest of them are. But anyway, when the time came for me to go back to Colorado to face a really nasty divorce, Gail went with me. at her own expense, Betsy and Garris got me a plane ticket with some points because I was working a minimum wage job, which I loved, but it didn't pay much. But Gail went with me, and I had forgotten until Betsy reminded me when the day of the divorce hearing, which was a nasty thing, Gail sat back there where I could see her, but the judge couldn't see her, and she coached me. And she told me when to shut my mouth. But anyway, we did have a great time on that trip. And I was so thankful for her friendship and her love. And like all of you have said, she was a wonderful friend.
She was a fourth sister to us. I grew up with Gail. I think I have the honor probably of being her longest friend for life. But Ann is my older sister, and then we have a middle sister named Trish, who could not be here today. Sorry, so we were sorry about that. But Gail did so much for all three of us that Ann and Trish started calling her our fourth sister. So I sort of identify with those of you who said that she was like a sister in your family. Gail and I met when I was 10 years old, the first day of fourth grade at Sternberger School, here in Greensboro. She had been going to Lindley Elementary, and her family built a house closer to Sternberger, so she was transferred. And we were the same Miss Pickett's fourth grade class together, and we met the first day and have been fast friends until the week before Christmas, when was our last conversation, but we're still fast friends. And we know that we're going to see each other again in eternity. And that is the greatest peace that I have in losing my friend Gail, is that we're going to spend eternity together because we both know Christ Jesus as our Lord and our Savior. And that's the most important thing I wanted to say about Gail. Even though we grew up together, we took trips together, we had fun together, we did all kinds of crazy things together. And I forgot to tell you, I'm Betsy Evans. I think Ann said I'm my sister Betsy. But Gail and I just... we bonded as youngsters. We got closer and closer through junior high and senior high. We roomed together for one summer in college. We took sailing trips together. We went to Maine and to Anna Green Gables and all that stuff up there. Yeah, one summer we did all kinds of things. We counseled. We were both counselors at Camp Cheerio together one summer. We did all kinds of fun things. But she made friends, it sounds like, everywhere she went, that were just as close to her as she was to me. The same thing when y'all said you talked to her on the phone, you know, she would update me on the grandchildren, the children, what everybody was doing. James was the light of her life. She used to, I started to say what she used to call you. I won't do that. But the girls, when they were born, Maisie and Ula were just her little dolls, and she just loved them all. She was so proud of David and Amy and their spouses and Sunday and everything. She loved all of you all so much, and she would tell me about you every single time we talked. When she moved back to Greensboro, it was just great. It's been, 25 to 30 years ago, somewhere in that range. And we were so excited that we didn't have to go to Virginia Beach and visit them or whatever, or they weren't seeing us only on holidays, because every time they came to Greensboro on holidays to see Gail's parents and be sure that they knew the grandchildren and everything, Bob and Gail always came over to our house, and we always managed to get together and do something fun or just visit. And the kids have some crazy memories, I think, of my husband and me. Especially at Christmas. I won't tell that story, though. I'll let one of your kids tell that someday. But the most important thing I want to say is, as Gail got older, I think she had a tender heart for Christ all of her life. I had a tender heart for Christ, too, growing up in the Episcopal Church, but I didn't know about having a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. I'd never heard it. I'd never heard about being born again and how important it was, and that was the only way to get to heaven. That God says, I am the way, the truth, Jesus said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Now, I didn't hear that. I didn't know that. Gail evidently learned it. And I got sort of frustrated with my church when I was a junior in high school. And so I went to West Market Street Methodist with her, where she grew up. And so we both sang in the choir there. And we were both part of the youth group those last couple of years in high school. But I think Gail gradually grew into understanding who Jesus was and her relationship with him, especially as she went to college and majored in Christian education and learned more. I think that's when she sort of gradually grew into it. Bob said when we were talking a couple weeks ago, he said he really couldn't remember definitely when she gave her life to Christ, could you? I think it was sort of a growing thing. However, for us, it was Gail and Bob who took Garris and me out to dinner. And this was probably we're guessing around 1979, when all our children were still little, but they took us out to dinner. We all went out to dinner together. I think it was Dutch, but we went to Chi-Chi's Mexican restaurant here in Greensboro, which doesn't exist anymore. And during the meal, Gail specifically shared the gospel with us and told us how to be saved. Now, if you don't know what saved means, the Bible tells you that if you have to be saved, you have to be born again to be saved in order to go to heaven and be with Jesus Christ eternally. If you're not saved, it's saved from your sin. That's what it means. Being saved from all your sins that Christ took on you, on himself at the cross. And if you are not saved from your sins, then you will spend eternity in eternal damnation in hell. And so he tells us very, very clearly how to come to Christ. And Gail told us that message that night. And we were sort of like, we don't talk about our religion. We grew up in a church that says, you don't talk about it. It's private. Well, I think it was private because we didn't know what we believed. We really had not been taught what we believed. And so even though I believed just from the services and the rote prayers and the Nicene Creed and all that growing up, I believed that Jesus was the Son of God. I believed that he died on the cross for my sins. I didn't understand all that. I believed that he was resurrected and went to heaven. So I thought I was a good person. I was a law-abiding citizen. I went to church every Sunday. I did good things for people. Therefore, I thought I was going to heaven. But you cannot earn your way to heaven. There's no way that you ever earn your way to heaven. The only way to heaven is with your personal trust in Jesus Christ, asking him to forgive you of your sins. First of all, admitting you're a sinner, which we all are. The Bible tells us all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. And they also tell us the wages of sin is death. But the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus. It's a gift. All we have to do is accept it. But the only way to accept it is to come to him in humility and say, Christ, I'm a sinner. Jesus, I am a sinner, and I need to be saved, and I'm willing to turn from my sin, to repent, to turn and go in another direction and let you be the Lord of my life. I believe, Lord, that you died on the cross and took my sins on your back so that I don't ever have to bear them again. You bore them for me. And I believe that you died and you were resurrected. You rose from the dead and that you are in heaven waiting for me. And I ask you to take my sins. And I'm trusting you, Lord, that I want you to be my Savior. Please, Lord, just be the Lord of my life. That's all you have to do, really. Just trust him in faith, knowing that he did that for you. And he did it for every person who's ever lived, ever will live. And so if you are not born again, I hope that you will say something along those lines, what I just said, a prayer to him, and ask him to cleanse you and forgive you, so that one day you will spend eternity. Eternity is forever and ever and ever and ever and ever in the new world. It's going to be, you know, a new heaven and a new earth one day. And eternity means we'll be there with Jesus Christ. We'll be there with Gail. We'll be there with all the brothers and sisters in Christ. Every person in this room who has been born again is a child of God. You are a brother or a sister in Christ. That means every one of us who know the Lord are Gail's brothers and sisters. And we'll be with her for eternity too. And all our other friends who've ever gone to heaven, who we know are in heaven, we'll be with them. So I just wanted to say, that's the most important thing. Gail and I used to talk about our funeral services. We used to say, we really ought to record what we want people to know and hear in our services. And we never did it. I still can do it, but I'm waiting for the rapture, which is horrible. I mean, I really ought to do it. But the most important thing she said was, I want to know that every single person who's in my funeral service hears the gospel message clearly, knows how to be saved, and makes that choice if they are willing to go to come to Christ and don't want to go to hell forever and be eternally in damnation. So you can't serve two masters. Scripture tells us that too. You either serve God or you serve Satan. And if you're serving Satan because you're a member of the world and just looking at worldly things and could care less about godly things and think that you are God yourself, you can control your own life, then you're serving Satan. But if you say a prayer of repentance and trust in God and faith in God and ask him to save you, then you are a child of God, and you will live forever in eternity in heaven. So that was the most important thing she wanted said at her service. I didn't know if Pastor Flack was going to have a chance to say it. I didn't know what. I was hoping that we would speak at the end so I could wrap it up if nobody else said it. But I've said it now. So I hope you've heard it loud and clear. And that's what Gail wanted, and that's what Jesus Christ wants too. So thank you for putting up with me and hearing me. Turn this off then.
Thank you. Okay, now can you hear me? So, I remember myself when my mother passed away that I wanted to hear every memory, even if it was a small encounter. And although I didn't know your mom and your wife very well, I did meet her. And I also spent the past 16 years listening to stories. I have listened to so many stories. I'm married to her. I'm so sorry, I'm feeling a bit overwhelmed here. I married her nephew, and I have grown up listening to stories of Thanksgivings, to stories of Christmases, to stories of the mountains. And it's a constant theme of love. And it's a very different upbringing to what I had, and it's an upbringing that I wanted my children to have. And I just wanted to just let you guys know that even though I didn't know her very well, on that first encounter that I knew when I came and met her in the mountains, I just met my husband and I was coming to America for the very first time. And that is where I learned that I love the mountains because of Bob and Gail. She also taught me what hospitality was like, what open-mindedness is like, She didn't know me very well. I'll be very honest. I was very young, inexperienced, and it was my first trip to America, and I was incredibly nervous, and she just made me feel very safe. And I really wanted you guys to know that. I know that it was a small encounter on my part, but I feel like I knew her because I just listened to those stories all the time. And it's like as if she's been part of my life for the past 16 years. So she's done really well. And just as a reflection of that, I know you guys. And just as a reflection of her love for you, I feel like I know her. And I'm really sorry that she's gone. And I'm really sorry. But at the same time, I know that she's going to be living through you guys. And so for the rest of our years here in America, I'm really looking forward to experiencing that.
Thank you, everybody, for sharing. Numerous references to being born again and putting our faith and our trust in Jesus Christ. And that most prominent teaching comes from our gospel lesson. So I'll share with us now John 3, beginning at verse 1. Now there was a Pharisee, a man named Nicodemus, who was a member of the Jewish ruling council. He came to Jesus at night and said, "Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who has come from God, for no one could perform the signs you are doing if God were not with him." And Jesus replied, "Very truly, I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God unless they are born again." "How can someone be born when they are old?" Nicodemus asked. "Surely they cannot enter a second time into their mother's womb to be born." Jesus answered, "Very truly, I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God unless they are born of water and the Spirit. Flesh gives birth to flesh, but the Spirit gives birth to spirit. You shouldn't be surprised at my saying you must be born again, for the wind blows wherever it pleases. You hear its sound, but you cannot tell where it comes from or where it is going. So it is with everyone born of the Spirit." "How can this be?" Nicodemus asked. "You are Israel's teacher," said Jesus, "and do you not understand these things? Very truly, I tell you, we speak of what we know, we testify to what we have seen, but still you people do not accept our testimony. I've spoken to you of earthly things and you do not believe. How then will you believe if I speak of heavenly things? No one has ever gone into heaven except the one who came from heaven, the Son of Man. Just as Moses lifted up the snake in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that everyone who believes may have eternal life in him. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe stands condemned already, because they have not believed in the name of God's one and only Son. This is the verdict. Light has come into the world, but people love darkness instead of light, because their deeds were evil. Everyone who does evil hates the light and will not come into the light for fear that their deeds will be exposed. But whoever lives by the truth comes into the light so that it may be seen plainly that what they have done has been done in the sight of God." Now, after his interaction with Nicodemus, Jesus and his disciples went out into the Judean countryside, where he spent some time with them and baptized. Now, John also was baptizing at Anon near Salim, because there was plenty of water and people were coming and being baptized. This was before John was put in prison. An argument developed between some of John's disciples and a certain Jewish man over the matter of ceremonial washing. They came to John and said to him, "Rabbi, that man who was with you on the other side of the Jordan, the one you testified about, look, he is baptizing and everyone is going to him." And to this John replied, "A person can receive only what is given to them from heaven." I appreciate everyone sharing and sharing your experiences with Gail and your memories and all that she left you and all the legacy of love and faith that she leaves behind. Miss Betsy preached our sermon today, so I don't have a lot to add, but thank you for that. But I do want to just share a couple thoughts, and that's that life is not easy. Things like sin and suffering and sickness, Parkinson's, they're a part of life. They're a part of life. But as real as they are, as powerful as they are, they don't get final say. Right? One of my favorite passages from Scripture comes from the end of Romans 8, and in there it says there is nothing, nothing that can separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus. And so as much as losing a loved one, a friend, family member, mom, grandma, as much as that hurts, even if it feels like the opposite is true, know that God's love and grace are right there in your midst. Know that Gail is covered in God's love and grace, and we all are. So this last painful time, this time suffering, dealing with Parkinson's, that robbed her of who she wanted to be, right? Who she wanted to be for others, the caregiver, the confidant, the sister, the mother, grandmother. That doesn't define her, right? That Parkinson, that doesn't define her. God's love and grace and the way she shared that with others, that defines her. I appreciate the words you all shared today. And I know everyone has their own memories of Gail that you cherish. And that's one thing to hold on to when you're grieving. Reverend Nick Scandale was a pastor here at Mears Chapel in New Gail Whale. Our original plan was that he was going to lead the service and then speak to you this today because of his relationship with her. But he has COVID and so was unable to be with us. Sent his thoughts to us this week and just wanted to share a portion of that, what he had written down, some of his thoughts about Gail. He wrote, "We are here to celebrate Gail's life and she wouldn't want it any other way. She had a unique joy of life during her entire life. She was a woman of consistent faith and truly selfless service. Even as a teen, she had a heart for ministry, guiding younger students at VBS, Vacation Bible School, at West Market United Methodist Church. She also served in their choir. Whatever she did, Gail always wanted people to come to know Jesus as their Lord and Savior, personally and intimately." Betsy had shared that, and that was important to Gail. And here's a memorable story. It said at the age of 16, Betsy, her closest friend, and Gail were visiting Betsy's mom's elderly cousin, Katie, right, in the small mountainside community outside of Brevard. So they were up in the mountains outside of Brevard. One afternoon, they were hiking a winding mountain trail, picking berries, singing songs from the just-released musical Sound of Music. And after a while, some of the local children, I guess, were drawn by that. They heard these people singing, and they came out barefoot, scrawny, and dirty. And so they came up to them, and these were kids from that had lived in a nearby, very isolated community, made up of kind of unpainted shacks, old trailers. And they taught them to sing Do Re Mi, right? Like Sister Maria. But more importantly, she also used this as an opportunity to teach them and tell them about the love of Christ. Ask them if they knew Jesus, could they sing Jesus Loves Me? And so right there, those children heard about Jesus, the love of God found in Jesus, in a most unlikely situation because of Gail and Betsy's willingness to share. So even as a young person, as a young teen, she had a heart for bringing people to Christ. Many of you are here as beloved family members or as an adult friend through the years, maybe even a fellow Girl Scout. I appreciate Nick sharing that, sharing those memories. And what he shared was echoed in the obituary, speaking about how she dedicated so much of her life to sharing the love of Christ with others, especially youth and children. And those memories are wonderful and they are so helpful, but we also have to look outside of ourselves as we grieve in order to find that true hope. And we live in a fallen, imperfect world. And sometimes we're going to question what and why something is happening in our lives. And we might ask God why. And that's okay, because God is big enough and strong enough to take any questions we might throw his way. But it helps when we see God as part of that process, walking alongside us during our lives, lovingly welcoming us into his presence when our time on earth is through. Back when I was in seminary, I worked at a women's prison. I was a chaplain at the women's prison outside of Atlanta. And that was a very difficult time, but very grace-filled as well. And so it was challenging to walk alongside these women, to speak with them and meet with them and hear how their lives have been turned upside down, right? And to hear when they said, well, why do certain people still tell us, well, God has a plan for me. How does God's plan end up with me in prison, right? And so to try and work out with them what that means when we talk about God's plan. And so I wanted just to make the same distinction with you all that I made with them, and that is the suffering that we go through in life, that is not God's plan. That's not God's plan. God's plan comes because he knows that suffering is a part of life, that tragedies beyond our control, that mistakes and poor choices we sometimes make, that stuff leads to suffering. But God doesn't cause the suffering. God's plan was to be with us, to live among us in the form of Jesus Christ, to suffer death on the cross, to reveal the depth of his love for us, and to rise from the grave to give us hope and grace. And so we see that plan, because God suffered, God is able to even be in the midst of our suffering and love and redeem us. And so we know that no matter what, no matter what you're going through, no matter the grief you feel when you lose a loved one, someone as special as Gail in your life, that you are surrounded by God's love, that you are not alone, that you are surrounded by friends and family, a community. God created us not to go through life alone. He created us to rely on one another. So love one another, support one another in these difficult times. Jesus described our ultimate destiny as a house with many rooms, right? We read from John chapter 3. Later in John 14, he's speaking to the disciples. And he says that my Father's house has many rooms. If that were not so, would I have told you I am going there to prepare a place for you? If I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you may be where I am. And you know the way to the place where I am going. And that way is through him, by trusting and putting our faith in him. Jesus described that house as created by God, a house where we dwell together joyfully in God's presence. God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And we, even in the midst of our grief, put our faith and our trust, knowing and believing that right now, Gail is in that house. She is at peace. She is no longer suffering. And we that remain here on earth may still feel that grief, but we do know that we will all be together in that house, and that we don't have to go through this process alone, because God is with us. Let us pray. God of us all, your love never ends. When all else fails, you are still our God. We pray to you for one another in our need and for all anywhere who mourn with us this day. To those who doubt, give your light. To those who are weak, give your strength. To all who have sinned, grant your mercy. To all who sorrow, give your peace. Keep true in us the love with which we hold one another. In all our ways, we trust you, and to you with your church on heaven, or on earth and in heaven, we offer honor and glory, both now and forever. Amen. Let's sing our closing hymn together, hymn 377, It Is Well With My Soul. Let's rise and sing. I'll dismiss us with a benediction, and once I do that, we'll allow the family to be dismissed first, and they'll make their way over to the fellowship hall and for a time of refreshments and visitation. So we'll let them go first, and then we'll all follow after that. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of His Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be among you now and remain with you always. Go in peace. Amen.